Yeah. Welcome. Welcome.
You guys ready to have some fun real quick? Impromptu. Yeah.
Let's go. Life does get tough. No need to stress. Hold you back too much. Let's go. I heard they found a solution. Where will you be for the revolution?
High school is a strange time in life.
It's not until you graduate and become an adult that you realize how insignificant that short period of time really is. Through those tremulous years and beyond, Kid Cudi has served as a guide to me, a sonic mentor, if you will. I think his impact stems from his willingness to express the pain and emotion he's felt in life. And that's rare in any field, let alone in a genre often defined by machismo. For the past decade, Kid Cudi has gifted us with a plethora of music, and this past year felt like his resurgence. I think in the coming years there are big things to come from him, but I wanted to take a look at his come up and discography, so we can get a better understanding of the impact he's made on music.
Plain Pat, what up?
My heart thump, not from being nervous sometimes. I'm thinking God made me special here on purpose. So all the while till I'm gone, make my words important. So if I slip away, if I die today, the last thing you remember.
Scott Mescudi was born and raised in Cleveland, Ohio, in a lower middle class home with three siblings and his elementary school teacher mother, Elsie. She raised Scott and his siblings on her own after Cudi's father passed away from cancer. Cudi was 11 years old at the time.
When I think of strength, I think of a woman. I was raised by my mom, you know? And that is something that she's someone I always will look up to, how she just sacrificed everything and took care of us, you know, on a teacher's salary.
Elsie has always been supportive of Scott's creative pursuits. She pushed him to join the school choir when she caught him singing under his bed one day. She'd buy Scott comic books to encourage his drawing. And when he took a serious interest in rap, she supported that too. After high school, Cudi enrolled at Toledo University, but dropped out after a year to move to New York to pursue a music career. All Scott had was $500 cash and a mixtape he had made 2 years earlier called Rap Hard.
It's all cool when they meet Mr. K.I.D. Automatically head in the VIP. Turn it up, beats blazing, hot as hell. I got the bank.
For the first 5 months, Scott stayed with his uncle and tried to find any minimum wage job he could. During this stretch, he didn't write or record any music because he was so preoccupied trying to get on his feet. At this time, even buying music was out of the picture, which makes his chance encounter with Kanye even more ironic.
Oh, at Virgin Music Store. And I was looking at CDs that I couldn't buy. And he was standing right next to me. And I saw him and I was like, oh my God. And I was like, Kanye West, you know, I had just moved to New York. I'm from Cleveland. So okay. I was like, I'm Scott, man. I'm from Cleveland, Ohio, man. And I remember him being like, hold on 1 second. Hey, man, I'm going to call you right back. And him being like, yeah, so what's up? And I was just like, I'm from Cleveland and I do music. And I really want to be signed. Can you sign me? He's like, man. I got so many artists right now, man, that I'm trying to deal with right now. He's like, and unless you want some Biggie and Tupac type stuff or whatever. And I was like, nah, I'm not that good, but I have the potential for greatness.
Cudi was working at Abercrombie & Fitch when a coworker introduced him to Dot the Genius, an engineering student at NYU who made beats. Cudi and Dot quickly became close and started making music together. Around this time, Cudi's uncle forced him to move out before he had any time to find another housing situation. With no options or money, Cudi prepared to swallow his pride and move back to Cleveland. That's when Dot's parents stepped in. Dot's dad took Cudi aside and said, "You can stay here as long as you like." So with Cudi living down the hall from Dot, the two worked more than ever and started to hone their sound. One night in early 2007, inspired by loneliness, job struggles, and a strained relationship with his uncle who died earlier that year, Cudi wrote a hook that he presented to Dot. 2 days later, the song was finished.
It was really simple. If you heard it, you wouldn't thought nothing of it. But in my brain, I heard it a different way, you know?
So like on my phone, it was more like. Like it was really simple. And then I didn't have anything but day and night. I toss and turn, I keep stressing my.
And found his way to Emil Haney, a producer who was friends with Kanye West's A&R Plain Pat. Shortly after, Plain Pat brought Cudi to Emil's studio and the two clicked immediately. At this point, Pat and Emil were managing and producing him. Cudi hunkered down at Emil's studio in Soho and got to work on his debut mixtape. At this time, the Crookers remix of Day and Night took off and grew Cudi's popularity internationally. Soon, he booked a two-week tour of Australia, which meant Cudi had to quit his job at the Bape store.
And I had to quit that job. That was, like, really hurtful. Like, to quit the job that I always wanted, but I had the opportunity to tour Australia. Like, I was like, man, I have to chase this, man.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I ain't never been nowhere. I love the Bape store, but I didn't come here to work at the Bape store, right? So here we are making that choice to quit the job of my dreams. To make a long story short, we did that tour. I came back. It was like 2 days. I was like, man, I ain't got no job. Well, what the fuck we gonna do now, you know? And Plain Pat calls me up, and he's like, yo, so Kanye wants you to come to Hawaii.
Wow.
And they flew me out there. And the first night I got there, like 8 p.m., I get to the studio. Say what up to everybody, Ye's there. And you know, he's so excited. So he comes to me, he's like, yo, I got 8 beats already and you can just start vibing to and writing to, you know? And I was like, all right, cool. So, you know, he gives me all the beats and I'm sitting on the patio and I'm just chilling. I was like, man, how can I make, like basically I had to pretend like I was Jay-Z. Mm-hmm. Like a man that's rapped about everything. Like what, like I have to make a hook for him. Like I have to make, cause a hook is the chunk. The hook mm-hmm. is the song, you know? And, I was really nervous, and I was sitting, this when I smoked cigarettes at the time, and I was just smoking all these cigarettes back to back, and I remember I had one idea, and I was scared to tell Ye about it, but now I was just like, man, you can't, you know, can't be pussy about it, so you gotta tell him. And then he comes outside, but before I can get up and tell him, he's like, yo, so you got something? Like, he was so ready. Mm. I had maybe been there for like 30, 45 minutes, but luckily, I was inspired by this one beat, and it was already home jam. And I had that, and I was just like, oh, you didn't want me to fall. He's like, yo, that's crazy. Get in the booth right now.
Yeah. After returning to New York again with an official Kanye co-sign, Cudi was ready to share his project with the world. On July 17, 2008, he released his debut mixtape, A Kid Named Cudi. I will. And bang.
I come from Cleveland, y'all can really hear it now. Hit them like comic books, kaboom, pow, pow. Into a girl's mind.
The release showed people that Cudi was much more than a one-hit wonder. His versatility was evident, with some songs being fun and carefree, while others are more painful and vulnerable. The mixtape was a sound no one had really heard before.
It's like I would play all my stuff for everybody, you know, and all my people would give me feedback, you know, and they'd be like, yo, why your shit sounds so different? And I'd be like, why not, nigga?
Following the mixtape's release, Cudi signed to Good Music, and he helped Ye craft 808s and Heartbreak. A few months later, he was named as part of XXL's freshman class of 2009. 14 months after the release of his mixtape, Cudi released his spectacular debut album, Man on the Moon, and The End of Day.
I make a say. What up? Me first. She wanna have whatever she like. She can if she bring her friend.
Man on the Moon is a concept album that dives deep into the mind of Scott, a man who's burdened by anxiety and the pressures of living up to people's expectations. This dreamlike album has 5 distinct acts, with each one bringing its own feel. The album opens with Soundtrack to My Life, which is a high-energy, rap-heavy song that showcases Cudi's endless introspection.
I got 99 problems, and they all bitches wish I was jigging, man. Carefree living, but I'm not Sean or Martin Louis. I'm the Cleveland nigga rolling with the Brooklyn boy.
Solo Dolo sets up Act 2 by stepping into the darkest side of his dreams.
No. Oh, oh, oh. Why must it feel so wrong when I try and do right?
The smash hit Day and Night is the third act, where Cudi shifts from darkness to optimism about the future.
To free his mind is searcher, to free his mind is searcher, to free his mind is searcher.
Day and night, the lonely loner.
Pursuit of Happiness returns the album to introspection, with Cudi seeking temporary happiness through drugs and alcohol. It's a cycle he's unable to break free from that ultimately results in his failure.
Crush a bit, little bit, roll it up, take a hit, feeling lit, feeling right, 2 a.m. summer night, I don't care, hand on the wheel, driving drunk, I'm doing my thing, rolling.
Up Up and Away closes the album and returns the record to an uplifting vibe, with Cudi pointing out that people will judge you no matter what, so live your life and move in a positive light.
I'll be up, up and away, up, up and away, cause they gon' judge me anyway, so whatever.
Cudi's ability to convey emotion was so relatable that it attracted a massive group of fans. The music was different, and as Cudi noted, it wasn't a bad thing. On November 9, 2010, about a year after the first album's release, Kid Cudi dropped his second studio album, which is personally my favorite Cudi album, Man on the Moon 2, The Legend of Mr. Rager.
Didn't let in the skinny jean wear a fro for days in the OAA, bounce so low, most fools couldn't price me, silent stunt with a blunt full of PE, take a shower, your attitude stinks, wanna know what I think. Mojo so dope, bitch. My mojo so dope.
Yeah, we live it, yeah. Oh, we own it. Give a fuck about your lifestyle. Give a fuck about a motherfucker life.
Cudi said Man on the Moon 2 is dark by nature, and instead of bringing you into my dreams like my first album, I'm bringing you into my reality, both good and bad. The album follows similar themes from his debut album by touching on depression, loneliness, and addiction. The latter is the topic of one of my favorite songs off the album, Mr. Rager.
Whoa now, hey!
Following this project, Kid Cudi released a rock album called Wizard with his friend and longtime collaborator, Dotta Genius. A year later, on April 12, 2013, Kid Cudi released his third studio album, Indicud.
I'm what you may got, fuck yes I'm so odd, think about all my old friends who want my friends all along. When it rains it pours, whiskey bottles on the sinks and floors, every day the five stays a chore, Mr. Dream with no exit doors. I need
This is the first album where Kid Cudi handled all the production himself. He said the song Just What I Am, which is playing right now, took him 10 minutes to make. Indicud is a different feel from both the Man on the Moon albums, with more upbeat songs splashed throughout the tracklist. In my opinion, this album has aged remarkably well, and that's a credit to Cudi's unique production.
I got the niggas that I need with me. Any issues, my nigga, you know the please hit me. No questions, no hesitation when it come to holding fam down. If you creep me the fuck out, you probably ain't around. Now you can hate on the side.
For sake of brevity, I'm not going to dive into Cudi's next two albums, Satellite Flight and Speed and Bullet to Heaven. These records didn't quite resonate with me, but I think there's still something to be said about Cudi's willingness to make exactly what he was feeling at the time. And really, that's what great artists do. They explore new sounds and recreate themselves. On December 16, 2016, Kid Cudi released his latest solo studio album, Passion, Pain, and Demon Slaying. Throughout the album, Cudi mixes his signature hums with confessional raps. In a way, this is a record that felt like it had been a long time coming. It felt like the Cudi we all fell in love with when we first heard him. In October 2016, Cudi revealed on his Facebook page that he had checked himself into rehab for depression and suicidal thoughts. As he's indicated in many of his lyrics over the years, Cudi has long battled with a drug addiction to cocaine. In an episode of Red Table Talk, Scott shared that a lot of the bad stuff in life came from him feeling he had to live up to being someone he's not.
When the show was over, I was completely miserable.
Mm-hmm.
For a long time, I was not happy when I woke up in the morning. Mm. It started off with something as simple as that.
Yeah.
Just being like, why don't I feel okay?
Cudi added that he incorrectly thought these bad feelings were due to stress.
I found out that it was stuff from years ago when I was a kid.
Right.
Like from my father dying when I was 11 and, you know, and then my cousin dying and then my favorite uncle dying like 3 years in a row. It was just like realizing these things and being okay with it, finding peace with it.
Yeah.
He's now 2.5 years off cocaine.
It's a beautiful thing. I think just getting back out into the world, doing what I love again, has really been big for me,
mm-hmm.
you know? But then also spending time with my daughter.
Oh, yeah. Yes. How old is your daughter?
8.
Wow.
And my daughter is my world.
Perhaps the culmination of Cudi finding peace is Kids See Ghosts, his joint project with mentor and friend Kanye West. The duo released the album on June 8, 2018, and it blew me away.
It was one of those things where I kind of wanted to make a song that kind of let the world know where I was at that moment in time. I had the hook immediately. And it took me a while to come up with the verses because the hook was so good. I was just like, how can I follow that up?
I'm so reborn. I'm moving forward. Keep moving forward. Keep moving forward. Ain't no stress on me, Lord. I'm moving forward. Keep moving forward. Keep moving forward.
It's one of those things that kind of came to us. We were working on it at my house. Me and Dot, we just always kind of just bounce ideas, and I had him help me with that, and he made it better. That was definitely one of the first ones that we had on the album, one of the first songs that we knew we were gonna keep. Kanye went crazy for it, and I was really happy that he liked that joint because I was rooting for it. It meant a lot to me. I just needed a record like that at the time, and I thought it was just perfect. I just love it. It's just everything about it, the melodies, the hook, what it's saying.
I had my issues, ain't that much I could do. Peace is something that starts with me, at times when
Cudi said, I'm just creating a lot, with more love in my heart for what I'm doing and for myself. I'm keeping my family close and staying on a mission, which is making music that means something. Kid Cudi changed the landscape of hip-hop by inspiring a generation of young artists to be unafraid to explore an array of emotions. Ultimately, he made it okay to feel sad, lonely, and depressed.
You saved my life. I would have killed myself if I didn't have Kid Cudi. There's me. Any, if you're 25 and under, I truly believe that Kid Cudi saved your life.
Cudi, man. Kid Cudi's like really like one of the main dudes I kind of like looked at and listened to all the time. He saved my life.
I suppose the real reason Scott is regarded as a hero isn't because he's open about his struggles, but because he's living proof that you can rise above them.
Like really, my mission statement since day one, mm-hmm. and I'm getting so worked up talking about this, all I wanted to do was help kids not feel alone mm-hmm. and stop kids from committing suicide. Because
I know I could not be in a place so filled.